Today I'm going to start with streptococci, and as you all know, these are spherical gram-positive cocci arranged in chains or in pairs. All streptococci are catalase negative, whereas staphylococci are catalase positive, and that is the main differentiating point between the two. One of the most important characteristic feature of streptococci is the presence of hemolysis on blood acre. Some of these are going to produce alpha hemolysis, other are going to produce beta hemolysis, and then there is a third group of streptococci which are non-hemolytic and are thus known as gamma hemolytic organisms. In my previous lecture, I discussed the classification of streptococci, and one of the most important classification is Lansfield grouping or Lansfield classification, and this is based on the antigenic differences in the group specific carbohydrate present in the cell wall. And I told you that 20 different serotypes have been identified, and they have been categorized into group A to B. Now, group A, B, and D are the ones which we are going to discuss in this lecture. And these groups are very important because they are responsible for a variety of human diseases. Group A is Strep pyogenes, B is agalacti, and D are the enterococci or the non-enterococci. Coming to the morphology of streptococci, they are gram-positive cocci in chains or in pairs, as you can see on this slide, and they are non-motile and non-sporing. They have a capsule around them. In case of group A, this capsule is made up of hyaluronic acid, and with group B and D, it is polysaccharide in nature. These organisms are fastidious organisms. What do you mean by fastidious organisms? That they require special nutrients for their growth. In case of streptococci, they require blood for their growth, and that is why the selective media is blood agar. Then they are aerobes or facultative anaerobes, meaning that they are capable of growing both in the presence and absence of oxygen. Capnophilic is another term which I'm using over here. Capnophilic bacteria means that the organisms require 5 to 10% carbon dioxide for their growth. Then I have already told you about the hemolysis. It could be alpha hemolytic, as you can see over here on this plate, in which there is partial destruction of the RBCs, producing greenish discoloration around the colonies. Or there could be beta hemolysis, where the RBCs are completely lysed and you can see clear zone around the colonies. And the third group are the non-hemolytic streptococci, which are going to produce gamma hemolysis. Coming to the pathogenicity determinants of these organisms, now the pathogenicity determinant has been grouped or has been classified into the surface antigens and the extracellular substances which are produced by these organisms. And now we are talking about Strep pyogenes or group A streptococci. Now group A streptococci contains or is surrounded by a capsule, and this capsule is hyaluronic acid, and the capsule is going to prevent this organism from being phagocytosed. It has peptidoglycan layer which has the group specific carbohydrates on it, and these group specific carbohydrates are responsible for the Lansfield classification. And then you can see these fibers coming out of the cell wall, and these are the M proteins. The M proteins are believed to be the most important virulent factors associated with group A streptococci, and it protrudes from the outer surface of the cell, and it is going to interfere with ingestion by the phagocytes. Antibodies to these M proteins are going to provide type-specific immunity to the individual. Besides this, you can also see these R and T proteins. The R proteins are the R antigens, which are believed to be defective or ineffective forms of M protein, whereas the T antigens are the ones which are going to make this organism resistant to trypsin or pepsin. Then it also have lipoteichoic acid. Lipoteichoic acid is present on the surface, is going to come out from the surface of group A streptococci, and it is responsible for adhesion of this organism to the oral epithelial membrane, or in other words, it is responsible for colonization. If you look at this on this side of the slide, you can see a large number of enzymes like streptokinase, streptodornase, hyaluronidase, DNase, etc., which are produced by strep group A or strep pyogenes, and at the same time it is producing pyrogenic exotoxins, and all of these are responsible for disease production, or they are going to help in disease production by strep pyogenes. Coming to the most important part, which are the enzymes. Now, in your exam, you get a question on given account of the three important inflammatory related enzymes, or you are asked to write about the five important toxins or hemolysins produced by this pathogen. Talking about these enzymes, which are believed to be related to inflammation, the first one is streptokinase. Now, streptokinase is a fibrinolysin. It is going to activate the plasminogen to form plasmin, and this is going to dissolve the fibrin in clots or in the thrombi. It is basically used in the treatment of coronary artery thrombosis and in venous thrombosis in the hospitals. Next is streptodonase, which is also known as DNase. Four different types have been identified, A, B, C, and D. And they are going to degrade the DNA, which is present in the exudates and the necrotic tissue. Now, the most important is DNase B, which develops after skin infections or after pyoderma. And this can be used for diagnostic purposes in the laboratory. Then we have hyaluronidase. Hyaluronidase is going to degrade the hyaluronic acid, which is the ground substance of subcutaneous tissue. And this is also known as spreading factor because it is going to facilitate the rapid spread of strep pyogenes in the skin infections, and it is going to lead to a condition which is known as cellulitis. Then coming to the toxins which are produced by this organism, the most important is the erythrogenic toxin. Now, erythrogenic toxin is responsible for the rash of scarlet fever. The four different types have been identified, A, B, C, and D, and these toxins are bacteriophage mediated. What do you understand by this? Bacteriophage mediated means that only those strains of strep pyogenes which have a bacteriophage carrying genes for erythrogenic toxin is capable of producing scarlet fever and is responsible for this rash, as you can see on this slide. The rash of scarlet fever is very typical, and I'm going to discuss it later on. Now, what is the mechanism of action of erythrogenic toxin? This toxin is going to act exactly like the toxic shock syndrome toxin of Staph aureus, and it acts as a superantigen, causing massive release of cytokines, interleukin 1, interleukin 2, and tumor necrotic factor from macrophages and T lymphocytes. And it is responsible for the DIC test, which we do for scarlet fever. And again, we'll be discussing this later on. Then the next toxin is hemolysin. And there are two types of hemolysin, streptolysin O and streptolysin S. Streptolysin O is a hemolysin that is inactivated by oxidation, or in other words, it is oxygen labile. It is going to cause beta hemolysis only when the colonies grow under the surface of a blood vessel, but it is highly antigenic. And hence, antibodies to it develop, and these antibodies are known as ASO, ASO anti-streptolysin O antibodies. And the titer of ASO antibodies can be important in diagnosis of rheumatic fever. Next, we have streptolysin S. Streptolysin S is oxygen stable, and that is why it is going to produce beta hemolysis on the surface of blood vessel plate. But they are not antigenic, and they are not going to play any role in disease production, or they are going to, this organism. Then there's another group of exotoxins which are produced by strep pyogenes, and they are known as pyrogenic toxins. The pyrogenic toxin is a family of genetically similar soluble exotoxins, and they are produced by some strains of strep pyogenes. And these exotoxins are responsible for the toxic shock syndrome produced by Streptococcus, or it is going to produce the scarlet fever or fresh eating necrotizing fasciitis. The mechanism of action of these pyrogenic toxins could be like they can act as superantigens, causing massive release of cytokines, or some of these are encoded by temperate bacteriophage, as I have just told you in case of scarlet fever. The pyrogenic toxins can be exotoxin A or exotoxin B. Exotoxin A is responsible for the streptococcal toxic shock syndrome. And this streptococcal toxic shock syndrome is exactly like that of staphylococcus toxic shock syndromes. All the signs and symptoms are the same, and even the mode of action is the same. In other words, it is going to act as a superantigen, and it is going to release massive amount of cytokines from T helper cells and from macrophages. On the other hand, exotoxin B is a protease, and this is rapidly going to destroy the tissues, and it is produced in large amount by the strains of Strep pyogenes, and this is going to result in flesh eating, and they are known as flesh eating streptococci, and they are going to cause necrotizing fasciitis. As you can see on this slide, you can see the destroyed tissue. The tissue or the flesh is being eaten up. And I have also shown you on this, the same slide, I'm showing you the spreading factor, hyaluronidase, which is causing cellulitis. In cellulitis, there's infection under the skin, but you don't see, there's no eating up of the tissue or flesh. It is not a flesh eating condition. So cellulitis is different from the pyrogenic exotoxin B condition, in which the tissue is destroyed and there is going to be necrotizing fasciitis. Coming to the clinical manifestations. Now, the clinical manifestations of this organisms has been divided into three groups. Group A streptococci can cause pyrogenic inflammation or diseases, and these diseases are produced when locally where this organism is multiplying, and then it can produce toxogenic diseases like scarlet fever or toxic shock syndrome disease. And this is basically the toxin is produced at the site where the organism is present, and then it is carried into the bloodstream and it will go and produce the signs and symptoms of these diseases. Immunological diseases or post-streptococcal diseases. Now, these are very important diseases which occur when antibodies against a component of this organism cross-react with the normal tissue, or it forms immune complexes that are going to damage the normal tissues. These immunological reactions can cause marked inflammation, like there could be inflammation of the heart or inflammation of the joints, etc. But there is no organism in these lesions. So this is something very important, and we will be discussing this part in detail later on. Now, what is pharyngitis? Pharyngitis is a common infection of the throat. The patient is going to present with difficulty in swallowing. There's going to be fever. If you look at the throat, it is going to be inflamed and reddened, and you can see pus adhering to the tonsils and and there'll be inflammation of the palate as well. Besides this, it may be accompanied by tender cervical lymph nodes. If the patient is untreated, the infection may extend to the middle ear, leading to otitis media, or it can go into the sinuses, causing sinusitis, or leads to meningitis. If the infecting streptococci produces erythrogenic toxin, then the patient is going to develop scarlet fever. Then the complications of pharyngitis, if the patient is not treated at all, then he is capable of entering the second stage of streptococcal infection, which is post-streptococcal complications, and that is rheumatic fever. Now, what is scarlet fever? Scarlet fever is a condition which is seen after pharyngitis caused by Strep pyogenes, and it is a bacteriophage mediated condition, which means that only those strains of streptococci which have bacteriophage in it, they are capable of producing this erythrogenic toxin. And the erythrogenic toxin which it releases is going to go into the bloodstream from the site where the organism is sitting, and it localizes in the skin, producing erythematous rash, which you can see over here. It is mainly present on the chest, and then it is going to move to other parts of the body. I hope you are able to appreciate this red chest or the erythematous rash, which is seen in this picture. The second important sign of scarlet fever is the strawberry tongue. The tongue is initially furred, white coating, as you can see over here, and later it becomes reds in color, just like strawberry, and that is why it is known as strawberry tongue, and it is one of the very important characteristic features of scarlet fever. The face of the individual is initially red, it is all red except for pale area around the mouth, and this is known as circumoral pallor. Circumoral pallor is flushing of the face, of the body and the face, with pale area around the mouth. Now, DIC test is done to detect the patient's immune status in case of scarlet fever, and you're going to inject intradermally erythrogenic toxin in the arm of the patient suspected of having scarlet fever. If antitoxins are present, then it is going to neutralize the toxin which you have injected in the patient, and there will be no skin reaction. So the DIC test is going to be negative and this patient is believed to be immunized. However, if there's marked redness of the skin in 24 hours, then the DIC test is positive, and it is believed that because there were no antitoxins, the toxin which you have injected has produced its effect, and the patient is a susceptible person who should be given antibiotics. Exotoxin B is another pyrogenic toxin. As I told you, it is a protease and it is rapidly going to destroy the tissue, as you can see here on this slide. The tissue is eaten up. You can see it is the hollow areas here and there, and this exotoxin B is also known as flesh-eating toxin, and the condition is known as necrotizing fasciitis. There are several skin infections produced by Strep pyogenes. One of them is impetigo, and we did discuss impetigo with Staph aureus. So both Strep pyogenes and Staph aureus are capable of producing these crusty yellow lesions, which are mainly seen on the face in infants and in children. And these superficial lesions, when they break down, when the crust is removed, they are going to leave superficial weeping lesions behind. So this we have done in detail with Staph aureus as well. Another slide showing you skin and soft tissue infections, and you can see cellulitis here, which is basically because of enzyme hyaluronidase, and this hyaluronidase is also known as the spreading factor because it is going to facilitate the spread of this organism. You can see the marked redness of the leg, and even here you can see that you can appreciate the cellulitis together with formation. There is large blister formation seen here as well. Erysipelas is again a cutaneous infection, and this involves the dermal lymphatics mainly of the face, and it is going to produce a characteristic lesion which is known as butterfly wing rash seen on the face. This butterfly wing rash is very typical of erysipelas, and it is mainly seen in older people, and the patient complains of fever and this stinging sensation of the face. And you can see this marked redness on the cheeks and on the bridge of the nose. Coming to the post-streptococcal diseases, which are also known as immunological or non-suppurative diseases. Now, this part is very important from your examination point of view, because you generally get a question on these post-streptococcal diseases. What are these diseases? These are disorders in which the local infection with group A streptococci is followed later by inflammation in an organ that is not infected earlier by streptococci. This inflammation is caused by an immunological response to the streptococcal M proteins that are going to react with human tissue. Some strains of Strep pyogenes have M proteins that are nephritogenic, and they are responsible for acute glomerulonephritis. Other have M proteins which are rheumatogenic, and hence they are responsible for acute rheumatic fever. Coming to acute rheumatic fever, which is the first complication of acute streptococcal pharyngitis, and it is generally seen 2 to 3 weeks after sore throat with Strep pyogenes, and 0.5% of all children could be affected. The clinical manifestation of this condition has been defined by Jones, and it is now known as modified Jones criteria. And according to him, if the person has two major manifestations or one major and two minor manifestations, he would be labeled as having acute rheumatic fever. Coming to the major manifestations, let's go to the next slide. Could be chorea, carditis, erythema marginatum, or polyarthritis. What is chorea? Chorea is actually involuntary movements of the face or the limbs, and this is because of involvement of the brain. Carditis, on the other hand, damages, it is basically damage to the myocardial or endocardial tissues, especially the mitral and the aortic valve, and this results in vegetations on these valves. Then we have erythema marginatum, which is mainly seen on the torso or on the trunk, and they are going to be for the formation of red rings on this area. Polyarthritis is inflammation of the joints, could be large joints or small joints, and they have become very painful and inflamed. The major manifestations are fever, and most important is a history of recent sore throat or history of sore throat in the previous 6 months. The patient also develops subcutaneous nodule, as you can see on this slide. Now, these nodules are formed beneath the epidermis, and the skin over it is inflamed, as you can see over here, and it is related to carditis. Patients who develop carditis also have these subcutaneous nodules. This is another picture showing you the various symptoms of rheumatic fever. You can see this pink rash in ring forms over the torso. This is erythema marginatum, and you can see the inflamed joints which are swollen and red. What is the pathogenesis of acute rheumatic fever? Now, this is believed to be an immunological reaction to antibodies which are formed against M proteins, and these are the rheumatogenic strains of M proteins, and these antibodies are going to cross react with the antigens of joint, heart and brain tissue. But there are other schools of thought regarding the pathogenesis. It is also believed that there may be direct toxicity of the exotoxins produced by streptococci, and these exotoxins can directly damage the heart tissue. And thirdly, there might be actual invasion of the heart by streptococci. The antigens are localized within the damaged heart valves, and they can produce this effect. Now, if you take the cultures from of blood or from the joints or from the heart, they are going to be negative for strep pyogenes. But antibodies, anti-streptolysin O titers, are markedly raised in these people. Coming to the next post-streptococcal or non-suppurative disease, and that is acute post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Now, this is also a serious complication, but this is seen after skin infections. 2 to 3 weeks after strep pyogenes skin infections, the patient may come up with acute glomerulonephritis, and it is the nephritogenic M strains which are mostly involved. The most common strain is M49, and 10 to 15% of the children with these skin infections can develop acute glomerulonephritis. Antibodies are formed against this nephritogenic M strains, and this results in antigen-antibody complexes. As you can see over here, they are going to go and settle down on the glomerular membrane, causing marked inflammation by activating the complement system, as a result of which there is going to be decrease in the glomerular filtration rate. Besides this, the patient is going to present with marked edema, especially it is facial edema known as periorbital edema around the eyes. The blood pressure is raised, the patient has headache, there is weight gain because of water retention. And if you look at the urine microscopically, you will see that it has blood in it. And this presence of blood and protein in the urine makes the urine smoky urine, which is a characteristic feature of acute glomerulonephritis. The patient is also going to complain of oliguria, less urine coming out, and dysuria, which is a difficulty in urination. Pathogenesis is again antigen-antibody complex formation. In this, these complexes are deposited in the kidney glomerular basement membrane. It is going to activate the complement, producing marked inflammation, and they are going to be deranged renal functions. Second school of thought is that there might be direct localization of the cellular components of streptococci on the glomerular membrane, and they can also initiate the same reaction. But again, here, strep pyogenes is absent from the urine and from the diseased kidney. Serological tests can be performed for final diagnosis of these conditions. And in case of rheumatic fever, the anti-streptolysin O titers or ASO titers are markedly raised. They can be 80 to 85% rise in this titer. Normal titer is less than 200 international units per mil. However, false positivity has been observed if the patient has strep pneumonia or tuberculosis, or there is Neisseria gonorrhea infection or rheumatoid arthritis. With acute glomerulonephritis, because this is a condition which follows after skin infection, the DNase B antibodies are markedly raised, and that is a diagnostic feature for diagnosis of acute glomerulonephritis. Coming to the laboratory diagnosis of streptococci, again we will be discussing it under day 1, day 2 and day 3. Day 1, when you get the specimen, which is from the site of infection, in this case it is throat swab, and then you perform Gram staining, you are going to see the typical chains, as you can see this on this slide, and they may be present singly or in chains. And you're going to put the culture on blood agar because it is a fastidious organism which requires blood as its main nutrient. Incubate it in the incubator for 35 degrees centigrade for 18 to 24 hours. Day 2, this is a slide showing you streptococci on pyogenes on Gram staining, and you can see a large number of pus cells over here, polymorphs, and you can see these Gram positive cocci in chains. This is another slide showing you chains of cocci, and this is taken from throat swab. Interpretation of colonial morphology, day 2, you're going to look at the blood agar plate and you're going to note clear zones of beta hemolytic streptococci. You will see these clear zones of hemolysis surrounding gray shiny beta hemolytic organisms, and these gray shining organisms are different from Staph aureus, which are golden yellow in color. They are opaque, larger, much larger than these colonies, and they are surrounded by a much bigger zone of hemolysis as compared to the streptococci. This is another slide showing you blood agar plate, and this is a throat culture was taken from a 5-year-old in which streptococcus pharyngitis was suspected, and you can appreciate here the hemolytic colonies of streptococci, and at the same time you can see these non-hemolytic colonies. This blue arrow is showing you the non-hemolytic colonies, which are the other commensals or the normal flora of the throat. It could be diphtheroids, or it could be like epidermidis, etc. Now on this plate we can, on day 1, if we are suspecting streptococcus pharyngitis, then on day 1 we can put up the bacitracin disc on the plate as well, and you can appreciate the zone of inhibition around this disc. So we are basically saving time over here, and if it is bacitracin sensitive, then we diagnose this case as streptococcal pharyngitis. Catalase we did with Staph aureus and with the Staphylococcus species, and we know that Staphylococcus species are catalase positive, whereas streptococci are catalase negative. If you look at this slide, this is a slide test where there is no bubbles coming out of this drop of fluid, indicating a negative test, so they are streptococci, and you can appreciate the bubbles coming out from the other part, which is from staphylococci. And staphylococci are the ones which produce catalase, so they are going to break down hydrogen peroxide into oxygen and water. This is the tube test of catalase. Again, you can appreciate the negative streptococci where there is no bubbles. You don't see any bubbles in this tube, whereas in B, tube B, you can appreciate the bubbles, and this is Staphylococcus species. Then at the same time, we can perform, if you have not put up the bacitracin this on day one, then you're going to do it on day two. You pick up the well-isolated colonies of streptococci and you inoculate it on a blood agar plate, and you're going to put up the bacitracin this on that plate. And the next day, you will see zone of inhibition around this disc indicating the presence of Streptococcus pyogenes. But look at the second slide. Here you can see the organism growing up to the disc margin. They are also beta hemolytic, but they are not sensitive to this bacitracin disc, indicating that it is not strep pyogenes, but it could be any other streptococci like strep A galacti, which is also responsible for beta hemolysis. Serotyping can also be done for streptococci, and this is basically latex agglutination test, where we are going to detect the antigen by using known antibodies. I'm not going to go into the details of serotyping here, because we are going to discuss this later on when we do a serological test. And the fourth is the antibiogram, which you're going to put up for this organism. Now with this, I'm done with the strep pyogenes, and I have given you assignment where there are questions. There's one SCQ and three MCQs. As I said, this part is very important. Mostly you get a question on the post-streptococcal diseases or on lab diagnosis. So please listen to this lecture carefully and then answer these questions. You have to give in your assignment within 2 days. An 11 years old boy presented with high grade fever, repeated sore throat, and on culture, we were able to isolate beta hemolytic colonies which were bacitracin sensitive. So if they are bacitracin sensitive, what is the most likely pathogen? You have to then give 3 major clinical manifestations with 2 examples of each, and then the examiner is asking you to write a note on one of the non-separative complications, or this means that the post-streptococcal complications produced by this organism, and how will you diagnose this case in the laboratory. And then we have these 3 MCQs. Please give the answers, read all the options, and then come up with the answer. Thank you very much.